Hello, everybody, and welcome to the next Open UK Future Leaders lunchtime training session. A little bit about Future Leaders Group. We are a collection of individuals who are interested in open technologies, including open source software, open hardware, and open data. It includes a wide range of people that work in technology, intellectual property, outsourcing, procurement, data, coding, and innovation, as well as private practice lawyers and in-house counsel that work in the technology sector and related fields. It operates under the direction of Open UK's Legal and Policy Committee and has a clear purpose to bring together people from across legal and policy matters relating to open technologies and to support and further the mission of the Legal and Policy Committee. The Future Leaders Group is currently co-chaired by me, Robert Brunells, and I'm from Field Fisher, and Katie Gibson from Bristowes, and we're both lawyers advising on technology and commercial matters. The group is always open to new ideas and new members, whether getting involved in all our activities or just dipping in and out of our various projects. I'm delighted to say that today we're joined by Frank Kartschkeit from Nextcloud, the founder and CEO. Frank is a major European hero in open source, and his talk will follow naturally from Oliver May's Ranchers last week, where we looked at running a business that was purely open source play. With Frank not only focusing on his businesses of OwnCloud, which he fought to then create Nextcloud, but also on the GPL and its place in business. I think it's fair to say that Frank is a major privacy campaigner in Europe and is credited with saying privacy is a foundation of democracy. And he's been, him and Nextcloud have been at the forefront of European privacy regulation for business. Thanks for joining us, Frank. I'll hand over to you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. Thanks for the nice introduction. And thanks a lot for having me. It's really great to be here to speak about a little bit about Nextcloud, but mainly about the GPL and why I and the whole Nextcloud team think that's actually a great free software open source license for business. So you already introduced me. Thanks a lot. My name is Frank Kartschkeit. I'm a free software developer for 20 years. Quite some time. I'm already founded different projects, the Open Desktop Org Network, the User Data Manifesto. Was actually a board member of the KDE EV for a while, invited expert at W3C, advisor to the United Nations regarding intellectual property and many other things. But I guess I'm mainly invited here as founder and CEO of Nextcloud. I want to talk a little bit about free software and open source. Maybe I can keep this a bit brief because everybody here, I think, is very familiar with the concepts. Then I want to talk a little bit about different open source business models. That's always an interesting discussion. And then at the end, we'll talk about why the GPL is actually great for business, specifically for Nextcloud, but also for others, of course. A while ago, this guy, Richard Stallman, it was in the 80s, basically appeared and he postulated the four freedoms. He has had a background as a software developer and working with software. He came to the conclusion that everybody should have those four freedoms. The first is the freedom to run a program as you wish for any purpose. So there should be no restrictions on running applications. The freedom to study how the program works and to change it. That's, of course, a perspective from a software developer where I really want to understand how something works and look inside and play around and change and improve things. That's a freedom everybody should have. Then the freedom to redistribute copies so that you can help your neighbors. At the time, it was still the concept that you give like floppy disks to your neighbors. Of course, nowadays we do everything over the internet. But to help others. And then the fourth, actually, the freedom to distribute your modified version to others. And that's the really important part, which makes it possible to build on top of the work from others. And this requires access to the source code. Because like actually having like open source in the way to access the source code is not really a goal on its own, but it's a requirement for this freedom or all four freedoms. Then a little bit later, the open source initiative created the open source definition. This was basically a different angle. And they came up with different requirements, but overall it's really the same idea behind it, that you can freely redistribute software. Source code is available. Derived works should be possible. The integrity of the author source code should be possible. There should not no discrimination against persons or groups or fields of endeavor. The distribution of the license, obviously, is required. And then that license should not be specific to a group or some software and should be technology neutral. So this is just a different way to define, in this case, open source. But I would say basically for this talk here that open source and free software are like 99.9% the same here. But what does it really mean? Now I want to talk a little bit why software licenses are important in the first place. Because the thing is, from a legal perspective, if I create something like a photo or music or a text or software, then I own it. That's basically the case in all countries. And then I, of course, can give what I created to a different person. But then the question is, and this is called distribution, but then the question is, what rights does the other person have? I mean, if someone gives me a photo, can I look at the photo? Can I give the photo to someone else? Can I print the photo and put it on my wall? Or can I change the photo? And if I change the photo, do I have to mention like the original author? And there are lots of questions. And these questions, what I can do with this, in our case, software, this is defined in the license. So this is why a license is really important, because without a license, I don't have any rights on anything. License basically tells me what I can do with something I get from a different person. And there are different license types. Let me go through them quickly. And usually or often they are described in this spectrum, in this scale here at the bottom. You have like public domain on one extreme, and then you have trade secret on the other extreme. And this is basically the spectrum that's often used to talk about different kinds of licenses. Let's go through it. Let's start with the one on the left, public domain. The idea behind the public domain is that I create something, piece of software, but I give up ownership on any rights of the thing I created. And it's then basically owned by the public. That's common in academia, 60s, 70s, 80s. The problem with this concept is it's not really possible in a lot of countries. So, for example, in Germany, at least, and I think it's the case in for a lot of other countries, you can't really give up ownership over something. Needs to be owned by someone. It can't be like owned by everybody somehow. This concept is not possible in a lot of countries. But then we go to the next one, the non-protective free open source software licenses. They are often called permissive licenses. This basically means that, okay, I create a piece of software and I'm still the owner of the software. This doesn't change, but it basically means, hey, I give it to everybody and you can do whatever you want with it. Sometimes with the requirements, just don't sue me. And these are usually BSD, MIT, Apache licenses. It's also common in academia in the 70s and the 80s, and that's still very common. And they're very common free software open source licenses. But now we move a little bit more to the right. Now we have the protective free open source licenses. These are the licenses that are often called copyleft licenses as a joke to copyright. It basically means that here is my software. You can do whatever you want with it, with the requirement that if you make a derived work of this, then you need to basically license it under the same software, license it under the same license. It means that if something is open source and I get it as an open source free software license with this kind of licenses, and I change it, I improve it, or do something with it, then I have to redistribute it like under the same license. This is basically some kind of insurance that this software, if it's open source, then it always stays open source. That's the idea behind it. And these are the GPL and the AGPL licenses, like mainly invented by Richard Stallman and others, pushed forward by the Free Software Foundation, very popular in the 80s and 90s, of course. So these are basically the open source licenses, the free software licenses. Of course, the next one, more to the right, now you enter the area of proprietary licenses. This basically means that you don't have the rights to do with the software everything you want. There are some restrictions. And these restrictions, they are different, but very often, I mean, if you look at the licenses for Microsoft, Oracle, Google, Apple, and so on, then the licenses basically say, hey, here is a software, you can use it like for your own purpose somehow, but you need to pay us money. And you definitely are not allowed to give it to someone else. That's very common software licenses. And that's, of course, then no longer open source and no longer free software. And then to the right, the trade secret basically means, okay, here is some software, but you're not even allowed to see it. Right? That's, of course, then all rights retained. That's, of course, then not useful and definitely not open source. Okay, so these are the different licenses. It means that if you write free software, then everybody can take the software and can do whatever you want with it. It basically means that the classic software license business, where you get money in exchange for the software, doesn't really work because everybody gets the software. Okay? But then the question is, how can you actually get paid for doing open source free software? Because the usual exchange, like here, you give you money, I give you a software license, or the permission to run the software, this is just not possible because everybody gets it. And that's something that is always an interesting question for me for many, many, many years. For example, in the KDE community where I was involved, as I mentioned at the beginning, that's a completely community-driven open source project. And everything the KDE community produces is 100% free software open source. Okay. So basically, there is no money, there is no customers, no money is exchanged in any way. They're all volunteers. Everybody is a volunteer. The problem is if you have volunteers, then that don't always have a lot of time because they maybe need to study or have a different job to make money. And you can't really concentrate full time on writing the software. And also a lot of volunteers that join the project and then drop out of the project because then they have a different job or change of priorities and so on. So this is always a challenge with volunteer driven open source projects. So for me, it was always the question, can we somehow hire people? Can we really pay people full time to write free software and open source? Basically, what is the business model? Is there a business model and how can we actually pay people for doing that? But the question is, what are customers paying for, right? What are they paying for if they don't pay for the license? Because license, you can't sell because everybody gets it for free. So, but customers need to pay for something, right? They don't pay if they don't get anything back. So what are they paying for? This question is usually then answered by a business model. That's what the business model is called. And now I want to go through some of the open source business models that exist. And what I did as preparation for this talk is I went to Wikipedia. There's actually a Wikipedia page about open source business models. And I find it quite interesting to go through them. Lots of them some of them are a bit funny, or some of them definitely don't really work or very theoretical, but an interesting thought experiment. And others are, of course, make a lot of sense. I come to them, to those later. But let's go through the list of open source business model as they are listed on Wikipedia. So the first one is selling branded merchandising. And it basically means, and that's practiced, for example, by KDE. So the KDE community, of course, has a nice KDE logo and has a KDE trademark, and they produce T-shirts or mouse pads or whatever with the logo on it. And at trade shows, they sell it. And they make money out of it. So that's an open source business model. Of course, you don't really make a lot of money with selling T-shirts. So I'm not aware of any significant free software open source community that makes so much money with merchandising to pay, like, let's say, 100 developers or something. That's nice to get some money, but that's not really the business model that you really want. The next is selling software as a service. This is something that is sometimes done by free software that is server based. So for example, if you are MySQL or MariaDB or Redis or some of those free software companies, then you could sell like a hosted version of the software, right? That you can still free software, you can download, do whatever you want with it, as I described. But they can sell like a hosted version of the software. And that's sometimes done, depends on what kind of software this is, but this is sometimes working. Of course, not for everybody. And if you're KDE, the KDE community can't really sell like a hosted version of KDE. This doesn't make sense. But for some software, this is an interesting business model. Partnership with funding organizations, that's sometimes a bit theoretical, that maybe there's another organization which already gets some kind of funding. Maybe you're the, I don't know, maybe there's the Red Cross, which gets a lot of money for humanitarian work. And then you sometimes somehow associate yourself as a free software project with them because you say, look, this is software that helps cure illnesses or something. And then you get some money from them. That's, of course, theoretically possible, but I'm not aware of a significant project or company that is like funded like that. Selling certificates and trademark use, that's interesting, because let's say you are, I don't know, you're Red Hat and you create like a Linux distribution, and then you could do trainings where you sell like certificates. Let's say you're an officially certified Red Hat engineer. That's something that exists actually, and for that you pay. Or trademark use. You can say, hey, you can put our logo on, I don't know, your website, but then you have to pay for it. Again, this exists, but I'm not really sure if like this is enough to fund like a real project or a real company. Donations, of course, that's something that a lot of free software projects do. They have a donate button and you can send some money. And this is actually significant income for like GNOME and KDE and some other volunteer-driven projects. And they get significant donations, but that's basically enough to pay like, I don't know, two people, a few people, like one, two, three, four, five people, but definitely not all thousand that are actually part of the community. So donations are nice, but again, it's probably not enough to pay like for all development. Bounty-driven development, crowdsourcing, that's interesting. There's sometimes the idea that, hey, someone wants to have a feature in a software and the person is like willing to pay like 10 bucks for the feature. And then some other person comes around and wants to have the same feature, and then they also pay 10 bucks. And then after a while, you have like $1,000. And then someone thinks, okay, for $1,000, I will work a few days to implement the feature, and then I get the money. That's the idea behind bounty-driven development. It exists. I mean, we from Nextcloud, for example, we experimented with that. But I don't think it's really successful, to be honest. So it's the amount of bounties that you get is definitely not enough to pay like for everybody. And you always have the challenge that, okay, then someone implements a feature, but then who maintains the feature afterwards? Or maybe the feature is developed, but the code quality is so bad that you don't really want to accept it. But then it is rejected, but then I don't know. Developer says, yeah, but I did the feature, so I want to have the money. So this is something that has a lot of potential for conflicts. And again, it's not really working nicely. Advertising, that's something that's possible, that you have a free software project, free software, and then in the software, you actually show advertising, like banners or something. And that's something you might say that, well, that's never acceptable. That's horrible. I would never use software like that. Well, there is actually one big example where this business model is used, and that's Firefox. So Mozilla basically gets like most of the income from Google for using Google as a search engine. And this is advertising. This is advertising money that they get from Google, and this is enough money to actually fund like the complete development of the full browser. And that's significant. So this is working. It's not the right model for every software, but you can definitely fund like the development of a complete web browser just by integrating Google as a default search engine. So that's interesting. Delayed open source is another one. Where you say, look, here, this is software that is not open source, not free software, But the version from 2 years ago is. If you want to have the current version, then you have to pay. But you can also wait a little bit and just use the old version, then this is open source. And there are some examples. GhostScript, I think, PostScript renderer used this kind of model in the past. And I think there might be some other examples, but it's definitely not very popular nowadays. Open source at end of life, that's also possible. I don't really think it is a real open source business model, but it is in the list. It means that, hey, this is full proprietary software. We sell software licenses just like Microsoft and Oracle and everybody else. But we guarantee that once, I don't know, the company goes away or we no longer develop the software further or because of some other reason, then if it's basically dead, then we open source it. Yeah, and that's not really an open source business model, but there are some examples where companies guarantee that, look, we are here, we are selling the software, but once we no longer sell the software for any reason, then it becomes automatically open source. It exists. It's weird, I think. Then we move into the area where we actually have some more realistic business models. The first is selling professional services. This is actually done by a lot of open source companies, usually the smaller ones, but I come back to this later. It basically means, hey, we are producing this software, everybody can use it. It's freely available, costs nothing. But if you want to have some consulting, if you want to have paid feature development, bugs fixing, workshops, training, and so on and so on, then you can come to the company and say, hey, I want that. And you know how to do it because you're the experts, you write the software. And then, yeah, they're paid for that and they take the money and put it into the development of the software. The problem here is that this does not really scale. Because if you want to have like more income from consulting, then you need more consultants or more developers or more people who do workshops and trainings. And you have to grow with like hiring this kind of people, but who is actually then doing the software? Right? Usually it is done like, okay, you're doing your normal consulting, workshops, training stuff, and then at the end of the day, if you still have a little bit of time, you'll do feature development, unpaid feature development for your core product. And this works still if you're like small, but if you're bigger, then this is not working. And I don't think there's an example for a bigger company which has this kind of business model. Then we have the next example. This also exists a lot. That's usually called the open core business model, or comparable to the freemium model in other areas, where the software, the core of the software is open source. And that's usually called something like Community Edition. But this Community Edition is limited, usually in features. And then there is the Enterprise Edition, which has more features. But the Enterprise Edition is not open source. So this is an example that it exists actually a lot. A lot of companies use that. I personally don't really like it because it is not really about open source. You basically use the Community Edition, the open source Community Edition, as a marketing tool somehow. But the way you really make money, your real business model, is actually a normal proprietary business model. So a lot of people in the open source community, especially in the contributor community, don't really like it. Yeah, companies use it. Then you have dual licensing. Dual licensing is also a very common business model. It's basically used in a way that you have the product under licenses like the GPL or the AGPL. Which means that you can do whatever you want with the software, but if you modify it, if you change it, if you combine it with other software, then this all also has to be under the same license. So this is a restriction that some people don't like. And if this is the case, then you can get the same software under a different license without this requirement, and this costs money. An example for that is was actually the Qt library from Trolltech many years ago, where the software was licensed under the GPL, which means that if you want to build software using this library and your software is also GPL, then it's all fine. It's compatible, works together, great library, great software, everything good. For example, KDE does it like that, right? KDE is also GPL license, so it's compatible with this license, everything fine. The problem is if you want to use the license to develop a proprietary software, then your proprietary software is not compatible with the GPL of this library. So this does not work. But then you can actually go to Trolltech, to the company behind that Qt, and say, hey, we want to have a special version which is compatible with our proprietary software. And for that option, we are willing to pay money. And this is the dual licensing business model. This is also controversial. It also means that everybody who contributes software to this project has to give up the ownership of the software to the company, because only then the company can actually release the software under different licenses. So this is something, again, exists, but not popular. And then we come to the end of the list, and now we are at the area of support subscriptions. So this is a business model, open source business model, which actually seems to work the best at the moment. So this is used by Red Hat and by SUSE and also by Nextcloud. So Red Hat, obviously, for a long time was the biggest open source company in the world. Nowadays, it's part of IBM, bought for like $34 billion, so a huge amount. And they actually use this kind of business model. So it seems to work. SUSE also calls themselves nowadays the biggest independent Linux distribution or open source company. They also use the same business model, and we from Nextcloud also use the same. So this means that the software is completely available to everybody, free software, open source. But if you want to run it in a professional environment, then you go to these companies and you buy support subscriptions. And then you get like basically everything that is needed to run the software in a production environment. And this is not the software itself, you already have it, but you have like support and certifications and long-term support, patches in a certain schedule, and so on and so on. Basically, the set of support subscriptions around the software that makes it enterprise ready. But the software itself is open source, and this is very scalable. I mean here is that you can actually grow your business without like hiring a ton of consultants. Basically, you can grow your revenue faster than your cost. It also is basically the fairest business model to the open source community, because it doesn't require code ownership. For example, going back to Red Hat, so Red Hat is makes their money with Red Hat Enterprise Linux, which is a Linux distribution. Well, but does Red Hat own Linux? No, they don't own Linux. The Linux kernel is owned by thousands of individuals and other companies, partly even the competitors to Red Hat. But they don't need to own the software. It's owned by the community. It's owned by everybody. They're just like bundling it together and make it available to their customers. So this is actually, I think, the fairest and also the best from a licensing perspective. So in the case of Nextcloud, the Nextcloud subscription, it basically means that if you buy a subscription from Nextcloud as a company, so this is targeted to big companies, by the way, not to individuals, then you get expertise, like you have the access to the engineers, you have like 24/7 maybe telephone support, you have long-term support, we will help you with migrating the software to a new version, influence on the roadmap, documentation, tips and tricks, compliance, and many other things. So this seems to be the best working open source business model at the moment. Again, Red Hat, I said it like super successful, $34 billion bought by IBM based on this business model. This is working. Okay, but now something changed because since a few years, we have something called the cloud. And the cloud changes a few things. It means that if you want to use MySQL, MariaDB, Reddit, Ubuntu, SUSE, Red Hat, and so on, then more and more you don't really host those software yourself, but you get it from the cloud. You basically get it as a hosted version from Amazon or Google or for someone else. And those companies then actually provide the support for the software. So you don't really need a Red Hat subscription. Or let's go to database, maybe that's better. You don't really need a support contract with a MariaDB itself, because you get like MariaDB as a service from Google. And then Google basically supports your software and you pay for that. And of course, Google doesn't pay MariaDB because they have their engineers in-house to do everything. And that's a bit of a challenge here. Several companies actually reacted on that lately. Super controversial, but I'm coming to that. The first example here is Redis. So Redis, again, they're sold like this kind of enterprise subscriptions before. And now with the threat from the cloud, they basically did a change lately. And they introduced something like that's called the common clause. It is an additional restriction in the software. It forbids to sell the software or offer hosting or consulting without a commercial license from them. Okay, so they basically introduced an additional restriction into their license. Which, if you remember at the very beginning of my presentation, so the statement from the FSF or from the OSI that said there should be no discrimination and no additional restrictions in the software. But this is exactly what they introduced, because they tried to protect themselves from the Googles and the Amazons of the world. Of course, this means that this is no longer open source. So here's a quote from Simon Phipps, president of the OSI at the time. He said, Redis just went proprietary. And that is, of course, completely true, because they introduced a restriction that you can't do everything with the software anymore. So Redis is now proprietary. It's no longer open source, according to this definition. Others did something similar. MongoDB, they introduced a server-side public license, again, with an additional restriction. Anyone who wants to offer it as a service needs a commercial license or open the complete infrastructure, which is, yeah, not really possible, right? I mean, try to convince Amazon or Google or Microsoft to open their complete infrastructure. Not going to do that. They can't then offer MongoDB anymore, only if they pay them. Again, this is a proprietary license. So this software, which was open source, is now proprietary. CockroachDB, very similar. And there are just a bunch of those software companies who change the license in that way. So there's this story here on TechCrunch. It was published here in 2018 with the title that I find interesting, The Common Clause Stops Open Source Abuse. So the idea here is that there is software that is open source, and open source is somehow abused, and that this common clause, which is a restriction in the license, stops this abuse. So I find this an interesting statement. I'll come back to this later. In my opinion, this basically means that what you're doing here is you're claiming that you save open source, but at the end you're killing it, because it is no longer open source. As Simon Phipps said, and the other experts too, these licenses are no longer open source. This is against the spirit of free software. So now let me talk actually why I think this is a mistake, what these companies did, and why I actually think that the GPL, if you really understand it, if you really live it, it's actually great for business. At least it works very well for us and Red Hat and others. So first of all, it creates the best communities. All contributors are equal. What do I mean with that? So if you know what Nextcloud is, if you use Nextcloud lately, then you see that Nextcloud really has a lot of functionality. It's really powerful software, which has a lot of features. I think personally, it's quite impressive what it can do nowadays. And how is this possible with a relatively small company? Because we have a super active, awesome, great community. So we have actually have thousands of contributors all over the world who work together to make the software better. And this is only possible because everybody is equal, right? Because if we as a company would decide that, hey, we are like, make the software proprietary, we do other evil business models, then all these contributors would run away. If you want to have contributors, you have want volunteers, then you need to do a lot of things. But the most important thing is that you need to be fair. So everybody should be equal. And that is guaranteed with the GPL, actually. Forks are always possible, and this enforces the best results. So if we as the Nextcloud company would do a bad job, then someone from the community would just take it and fork it and make it better. Okay, so if we somehow develop the software in the wrong direction, do bad releases, do, I don't know, bad stuff, then we are always checked by the community, because it's always possible that someone says, okay, well, this is like bad, I can do it better. I then take it and do it better. And this basically always holds everybody accountable to produce like the best results. Then the global upstream downstream network is only possible. What do I mean with that? So Nextcloud has so many features nowadays. It's not possible that we do everything on our own. We are using lots and lots of other open source and free software projects and connect everything together. I mean, just lately I saw that someone developed a face recognition extension for Nextcloud to recognize faces in pictures. And that's, of course, a super complex feature and only works if because the developer integrated some other open source software that already exists into this feature. And that's only possible if you are compatible with this other software. So because of that, it's very valuable for us that our software is normal HGPL licensed. So we can use everything. We're just compatible with this big open source community. We are compatible with everybody. And this makes basically means this upstream downstream network really work. So otherwise, if we introduce our own evil proprietary license, then we are a code island. We have to do everything because we are not compatible. And that would be a mistake. Then working with the best developers. We actually get a ton of job applications from really, really good developers from all over the world. And the reason is that lots and lots of good developers like open source. They like how it works, what freedom it gives, how the processes are, how fair it is with the community, and so on. So I think we are able to attract the best people better than proprietary software companies, because there you are, I don't know, maybe sometimes you're not even allowed to use the software you write yourself, or you have to pay for the work that you do yourself. And we are, I think, are able to work with the best people. Ecosystems are key nowadays. This means that we can integrate with everybody else and not really mean like libraries, as I mentioned before, but we can also work with other companies. And this creates an equal playing field again with the GPL enforcers. Again, if you remember at the beginning, the GPL means that you can build something and then someone else can take it, improve it, but then is forced to license it under the same license. And this means that everything is equal, right? Everybody has the same rights. And this is really key to build an ecosystem. GPL enforces a good community governance with licenses. What do I mean with that? There are some other licenses like the MIT or BSD or Apache licenses. And these licenses basically have the difference to the GPL and HGPL is that you can always take it and make it proprietary. So if you have a community, let's say like the Kubernetes community or the OpenStack community or communities like that, where a lot of companies basically come together to develop a software, then there's always the danger that someone takes the software and makes it completely proprietary and builds a complete proprietary product out of it, basically forks it. And that's something that is, of course, not good for anyone, because the whole purpose is that you create a software together. Together, you're stronger. And in these cases, you often need this governance structures, like architect councils and people who make sure that all the interests are somehow in sync somehow, that no one runs away and does everything on their own, that everybody works together. If you look at other software like the Linux kernel, which is GPL licensed, you don't have these architecture boards, you don't have these foundations that are basically making sure which pull request is accepted from whom. That's not needed because the GPL already enforces it. So that's a really good thing about the GPL, which is often overlooked in my opinion. Customers really like the GPL because there's no vendor login. Basically means that, hey, if a big organization is using Nextcloud, for example, then they come to us, hopefully, and we sell this enterprise subscription, support subscription, and hopefully it all works. But if we are somehow doing a bad job, then the customer is able to cancel the subscription and keep on using the software. And this is just fair. This is fair for the customer, and it also keeps us accountable, because if you're doing a bad job, then the customer goes away. And these are fair relations. And at the end of the day, I really believe that fair relations are really good for happy customers, and then also leads to a fair business model. Owning the code is not important. The value of a company is in the people. That's another thing. I really believe that the concept of owning software and licensing software is getting less and less important, to be honest. That's, if I talk to bigger organizations, bigger customers, then they want to work with a good organization, with good people, and actually owning things is less important. Yeah, and then the Red Hat CentOS strategy, it really works. What I mean with that is that CentOS is, of course, the freely available version of Red Hat Enterprise Linux. As I said before, you don't have the vendor login, right? You can use CentOS or you can Red Hat with support, and can you migrate from one to another very easily and has the same features, 100% the same features. And you only pay for the pieces, for the subscription, for the support you really want, but not for the license. Customers like it if they can freely distribute it and use it. We have this often where someone is using Nextcloud inside a company, maybe in one department, and then it becomes more and more popular, and then I just give it to another department, say, hey, look what we have here, that's very popular. Maybe, I don't know, everybody's in the home office now because of COVID-19, and we have this great tool that you can stay productive in the home office, and then suddenly more and more people use it, and then maybe later they come to us and buy additional support subscription or don't. But that's really nice that this is possible. It really helps like Nextcloud and also helps the customer. And that's only possible with GPL. If you have like proprietary licenses, not possible. Contributions flow in and out of the company, best for everyone. That's another thing, right? That basically customers and partners in the community can contribute into the core product, and people who work at Nextcloud can also contribute to other open source projects. And again, this is like guaranteed with the GPL, best for everybody. Again, it's just like basic understanding the way you work together. Then the copyleft licenses are clear and well understood and tested. So that's something that's also interesting, because sometimes, especially in the past, there were a lot of criticism that the copyleft GPL, HGPL licenses are complicated or not clear or bad for business. But the good thing about them is actually that they're discussed and studied and understood for many, many, many years, for 20, 30 years. And companies really know what this means for them. If you buy a software under a proprietary license, then it's really more difficult to understand what this license really means and what's in the fine print at the bottom of the contract, right? I mean, we all know the terms of services that no one ever reads. It's actually quite complex to understand what this proprietary companies and products actually mean and what influence it has and what I'm allowed to do and what I'm not allowed to do. The GPL in that case is like probably one of the most transparent and common licenses in the world. And it's really clearly understood what it means. Copyleft software can never die or disappear. Yeah, this is like another good thing because let's say a company disappears, it dies or it's bought or changes the strategy or something, that sometimes software is no longer available. And this cannot happen with open source and free software. Just as an anecdote, I mean, I think two weeks ago, Atlassian, company who's doing several productivity tools, they introduced, they announced that from now on or from next year on, all the software is only available in the cloud and you can no longer buy a license of it. Right? And that's, of course, really bad if you rely on that. Then you really have a problem. You really think, okay, the software we use here is then somehow no longer available. What are we doing now? And this can never happen with copyleft and open source software. It can never die. Even if a company decides to no longer develop it, then someone else can pick it up and develop it further, or several people together, and then someone wins. So it's really insurance, basically. The GPL v3 has patent protection. That's something that's, I think, is a really good thing. It basically means that it is that I'm protected, that by using this software, I'm it's guaranteed that I don't violate any patents that is baked into this software. So because that's software patents are always a risk for companies, but at least if this is GPL v3 software that I'm using, then I'm at least protected that there is no bomb, no landmine in this software regarding software patents. Now I want to give you some real world examples, again, to explain this a little bit further, what I want to say here. So as you might know, as I mentioned in the beginning, I also founded OwnCloud before Nextcloud. And that's something where at a time, because of different reasons, investors, other interests, we had a different business model, not so good one, in my opinion. Specifically the dual licensing and the open core business model, that's what I described earlier. And this required, as I explained earlier, that everybody, every volunteer, every contributor basically signs this license agreement and gives the company the ownership of the code. This really had the conclusion, really, I know several people personally and different examples where then contributors were unhappy and leaving the project. They say, yeah, but I'm just contributing open source here. Why do I need to sign this contract here? I'm not doing that. I'm not a lawyer. This is too complicated. I don't trust you. I don't want to give you any special rights. So I'm stopped contributing. And this harmed then OwnCloud, of course. Right? But they required that because of that, the dual licensing and the open core business model works. And Nextcloud, we changed that. We no longer do dual licensing and no longer do open core. Because of that, we don't require a contributor license agreement and we just accept every open source free software contribution from everybody. It's super easy. No lawyer involved, no contract, no transfer of ownership. And that's just, as I described earlier, this is fairer. But that's a real world example. Another example from the OwnCloud times where that people joined the company because they thought, well, that's an open source company. But at the end of the day, they had to develop proprietary extensions. So features that are only available for paying customers, not for the community. So at the end, they basically became a proprietary software engineer and no longer doing open source. And again, that's fixed in Nextcloud because everything we do is open source. Then sometimes OwnCloud customers were surprised about the vendor login because if you do open core or dual licensing, you're no longer allowed to use the software when you stop paying. This is something they were sometimes surprised. They thought they're using open source, but they're not. Again, we were able to fix that. Okay, so now you might ask, hey Frank, what is Frank talking about? Right? I mean, if the TPL is so great, why did these companies actually change their license earlier? Why did Redis or MongoDB and all the others, why did they change their license if the TPL is so great? Why did this happen? Why does the software become proprietary? So that's a bit of contradiction. Because of that, I want to go back to this article where it was written here on TechCrunch that the common clause, which is the proprietary license, stops open source abuse. Again, weird. Where does this come from? Why does someone think that making a software no longer open source saves open source? And the answer for that is actually, if you scroll a little bit down and you actually check who actually wrote this article, who is actually has this opinion, then this is article was written by a gentleman who is actually the managing director of a venture capital company. This person even proudly lists all the companies where this person is invested. Like you see, it's all this list of software companies. And that's, of course, the answer, right? Because if you are venture capital, then your interest is that the company owns the code, because then the value of the company increases, and then you can sell the company later for a higher profit. And that's, of course, the reason behind this whole discussion, in my opinion, because that's something. Nextcloud, as an example, we don't own the code. It's not needed. Right? And we, as a company, don't need to own the code. Our customers don't care. Our communities don't care. The employees, the developer, no one really cares. The only person who might care is a potential investor that we don't have, who is then wants to sell the company for a higher profit. But that's not the goal of Nextcloud and all these other companies. So that's the reason behind this whole discussion, in my opinion. So I really think that the GPL is actually a great solution for business, and there are many, many examples for that. And you should not be distracted by listening to venture capital investors who are looking for a big exit, because that's not the goal of free software and open source. So in summary, Nextcloud, many other software would not exist without open source. We would not exist, right? It's not possible to do everything on our own. As I described earlier, we need to do this together with the community, and that's a great thing. And that is like enforced by the GPL. I think we should not give up the four freedoms and our values for fast money, which is like the interest of some investors. If you really care about the freedoms of about the openness, about open source, then the GPL is great. Maybe the GPL is not great to do like the big IPO, or I don't know, or other things, but it's definitely great for the software freedom and for the users and the customers and the developers in the community. Okay, this was my presentation. Thanks a lot for the time. I hope, I don't know how it works, if you have time for questions, or maybe I used up all the time already.
No, definitely. We've definitely got a few. Thank you so much for that. We've definitely got a few minutes for questions if anyone's got any.
I can ask something. So, Frank, it's Amanda here. Thanks for that. I think it's really interesting. I know that you and I have quite similar, but not exactly the same views on lots of this. I had to step away for a second when you were talking about Redis and the Commons Clause. And I view the Commons Clause as an abomination. Their website says that you may not call software distributed on this open source, but of course you must not because it just isn't, as you pointed out. Did you touch on the whole strip mining piece and the stuff that was in the New York Times about AWS? That's the bit I missed, and I wondered if you'd talked about that.
What do you mean with strip mining? Sorry.
Yeah, so when you were talking about the concept of saving open source by, you know, protecting it and effectively making it not open source, the New York Times ran a piece, almost this time last year, just in the run-up to Christmas, talking about strip mining and how AWS was taking open source, doing it legally, as were other big open source companies, not doing anything that breached the licenses, but effectively They were using Open to build their businesses, which you can do, but then weren't contributing back, and how some of the open source companies were looking at, different actions against them. I think that followed on just after Elastic sued on trademarks. And with AWS, they've sort of been hung out to dry a bit. They've been used as an example of companies that can benefit from open source at scale, and how difficult it is in that environment that you at Nextcloud are in, that platform environment, how difficult it is to generate revenue when you give your software away and others can use it. And for these big tech companies, they can wrap it up into their platforms. I just wondered if you had any more thoughts about how to deal with that situation.
Yeah, that's a very interesting question, of course. I think there are two things to look at here. I mean, obviously, I'm not a big fan of Amazon and Google and Microsoft becoming bigger and bigger and bigger, and smaller companies have a hard time to compete with these big tech giants. That's of course a challenge. But the other side is of course that sometimes I have the impression that people talk about open source and free software without really understanding what it really means. Because it means if a developer or a company decides to release software as open source, it means, as I explained at the very beginning of my talk, that you give everybody the right to use it without any restrictions, without any discrimination. So you decided to give Amazon the right to use the software. And I find it then weird to complain that I use the software because that's the whole concept. And that's just how it is. I mean, it's a quite powerful statement in the open source definition when you say like everybody can use the software. It means that tech giants can use the software and make like billions with it. That's just what it is. It also means that bad people can use the software. That's another interesting discussion. Lately, there is some discussion about this moral software, or that you have some values in the software where you say, look, everybody can use my software, but not to kill people, or not for the military, or something like that. And that's an interesting concept, but it is not open source and it's not free software because they say everybody can use it. And also Amazon and Google can use it and they can make billions with it. What we need is a way to make sure that other software companies and cloud companies can exist and grow, and we have this rich ecosystem. But what is not a solution is somehow take away the right that Amazon can use it, because that's the whole concept of open source.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. And I think that what we're going to see is stuff coming out of Europe, and I know you've been quite involved with that, around data and how data sits at the heart of business models of all tech companies going forwards, whether it's high tech, big tech, or anything else. And that's going to be relevant to companies that build businesses around open source too. And I think we're going to see a shift. I've heard that the FTC or the Trade Commission in the US anyway, is investigating the big tech companies with respect to the service layer on cloud. And I'm sure that Europe hasn't missed that either, and how they create the platforms but then also compete. But once you restrict them and you make it more competitive, you take that lock-in away and you allow open to be more successful. So it'll be really interesting to see if that happens over the next months and years. But thanks, Frank. I think Stuart also wants to ask you something, so I'm going to pass on, but thank you.
Thanks.
Yes. Stuart, do you want to?
Yeah, will do. Frank, thank you very much for the presentation. Question is around OpenChain. So that OpenChain provides a really important structure around code governance, but it brings to focus a contention, a practical contention with the permissive and restrictive licenses. Clearly the community, as you've explained, it matters to the community that their investments can't be exploited, and that the community development continues in the way that they intend. But they benefit from the GPL, the restrictions around GPL, where the open chain really highlights this. In the corporate world, they struggle with these constraints and certainly prefer the non-permissive licenses, just thinking for their own compliance reasons, so that they know what it is that they're importing and know how that affects what they're exporting. So their primary focus is not exploitation, but it's the compliance need that they have. How do you think that might develop? Do you think there's a middle ground that can be found, which not only enables the community to have the benefit of the GPL, but also reduces some of the friction around the restrictions that brings from a compliance perspective? Are these two mutually exclusive positions?
Yeah, the Open Chain Project and Chain doing an awesome work here, of course. That's really really super important to work with those companies to make sure that we make progress here. I think that this is a conversation, that's a discussion that will hopefully be solved at some point, because I still remember like 20 years ago when the GPL was really seen as really hostile, anti-business license, viral, and not acceptable for anything. And I still remember when a lot of organizations basically rejected that they didn't want to use the GPL because they've seen it as a risk. It's not compliant. And this is something I see, this fear is going down more and more. Nowadays, you can go to a lawyer or a company and say, look, do you have Linux in your organization? It is actually GPL licensed. Linux kernel is GPL. Does it harm your business? Is it a risk for your business to have a Linux server? No, it does not. Right. Or do you have people using an Android phone? Well, it's also using GPL software, right? And is it a risk for your business? No, it's not. It's fine. And I think this is a mindset that less and less companies will have a problem with GPL style licenses. So as I mentioned before, Nextcloud is only available, the server, with HGPL. There's no choice. And the clients are only available with GPL. And I think there was one case in the last 4.5 years where we actually talked with a customer, and then the customer wanted to introduce Nextcloud in the company, but then decided against it because of the license, because it was not compliant. But it's one example out of 500. And I really think that this is something that will solve itself over time, because this restriction of the GPL, right? I mean, this is a minimal thing, because it only affects the case where you modify the software, and then you need to redistribute that modified software. But if you look at other software, Microsoft or Oracle software, which is compliant, you can't even do the modification, right? So I don't think this is a real problem. And this is a problem that would solve itself over time.
Okay, thank you very much.
What's your opinion?
Okay, so I guess the difference is between whether somebody is importing to use or importing to build on and distribute. And again, the experience that I've had in the open chain community is that there's no doubt that open source licensing is a bit Wild West at the minute. It's not yet sufficiently structured. And if you were to look at the various tools to scan code to find out what the licenses are, there's a significant amount of text searching to work out what the license might be of all of the code that you're importing. So there is that problem anyway, which is muddying the water. You know, there's a base layer of what license do we think we've got anyway. But given that that problem gets solved and refined, and the license issues gain the same level of community input as the code does, which people making PRs to improve license quality and add SPDX and so on. Once that becomes takes the mud out of the water a little bit, we're still left with the situation that an organization who is creating their own product where they're having to import GPL, they're importing code which may be GPL, creates obligations for them that may or may not conflict with other obligations or other criteria they have. So my view on this is, and the reason I asked the question to get your view, is that there is a clear, I believe there's a point where we don't yet have a situation where a corporate can comfortably import code that has restrictions, whether it be just a GPL3, for example, because that might impact the whole of their product and what they then ultimately have to do with something that depends on this. They might want to import Nextcloud as a component of their bigger machine, but they don't necessarily want to think about how that might affect other things that they're doing. So this is where I see the problem, and I don't necessarily think there's an answer. I was interested to get your view on it.
Yeah.
And you may be right. It may be that over time, someone cracks the problem, a new license comes about that gives the community the protection, yet gives the freedom to the corporate.
Good point. I mean, my answer, of course, I only cover the case where someone is using the software.
Yes,
because you're right. If you want to build a product or something on top of some other software, then of course you're completely right that this is an issue. But I actually want to make the point that I don't think it's a problem, because let's say someone creates some software, and the person or the organization really believes in the four freedoms, in the open source mindset, spirit, and then chooses the GPL to protect that. And then another company comes around and say, oh, that's nice software here. I want to build a product on top of this nice software, but I don't care about the four freedoms. And then, oh, I have a problem. I can't do that. I don't think it's a problem. It's actually the GPL working. It actually means that everybody who is building on top of my software needs to accept those four freedoms. And if someone, I don't know, if a big car company decides to use Nextcloud and turn it into a proprietary software, well, that's not possible, but that's a good thing. This is the purpose of the HGPL, to protect those four freedoms. So
I think that's really well said. And I think that really punctuates the point. One of the side effects of open source free software becoming mainstream is that the people who are now involved in important questions around system design, commercialization, and so on, really may not understand the subtleties of what open source and free software means. So you referred to that earlier, that kind of people bandy these terms around and don't really have that depth of understanding. So I think you're absolutely right. The things like AGPL and through compliance bring those conversations to the top. And maybe in the immediate term, it might be a pushback, but that pushback is an educational period of time. And maybe the outcome is that these larger organizations, or these people who really, the compliance is a critical part of what they do, it forces them, maybe the outcome is that it forces them to really understand what open source means, the benefit of the community, why their product relies on this community. So yeah, actually maybe that will be the outcome.
Exactly. So if a company wants to, I don't know, maybe they're, a car company wants to build a car operating system and then just uses all kinds of nice open source components to build this car operating system. And then at some point, like someone's looking into the compliance question, they say, oh, we can't really make this proprietary because we rely on this other open source components that are GPL, AGPL, and other licenses that force us to make the whole thing open source. Then, yeah, maybe they're then at some point come to the conclusion that this is actually a good thing, because to talk about this stupid example, but there's a does a car company need to sell software licenses for the operating system that's running in the car? Probably not. So this whole business model of like, hey, this is our intellectual property, we need to protect our, and then sell license or something, it's something that doesn't make sense for a lot of businesses anyways in the future. So maybe it will all sort itself somehow in the future, hopefully.
Yeah, it really does focus on what someone's business model is, and it probably isn't reselling open source software. They probably have a different value. This potentially becomes the value proposition conversation, so partly for them to understand their own value proposition, but also for the free and open source software world to educate these organizations as to why they can only do this because of the community, and why that has to be, that give back has to be respected, that license has to be respected. Maybe there's some marketing that our communities need to do to help these organizations understand how to work in this new world.
Yes.
Great. Well, thank you so much again, Frank, for a great talk. And thank you to everyone for joining. Next week, we've got John Laban talking about open hardware and circular economy. So hopefully we'll see some of you there. So thanks very much and have a good weekend.
Thank you.
That's great. Thank you.
Great talk. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.